Good morning, students. Once again, welcome to Banach Spaces class. So this is a session 3. So in this class, let us look at what are the subspaces of a nonlinear space and some theorems based on subspaces. So first let us take, say, you know, the nonlinear space X. X is a nonlinear space. Suppose M is any subset of X. M is any subset of X. From linear algebra classes, you know that we say M is a subspace of X if for any two elements, say x1 comma x2 belongs to M, the linear combination, say alpha x1 plus beta x2 belongs to M, where alpha and beta are any scalars that lies in the underlining field, say F. Usually we take F to be a field. So this is the condition for a subspace. Now, so can this subspace becomes a non-linear space also? Yes, definitely it becomes a non-linear space. Yes, the norm used for M is here only the norm of the superset or the base space, which is X itself. So the norm of X itself we will use for M itself. Okay, so if we restrict that norm to the subspace, that we may return it as by norm restricted to norm of X, which is restricted to M itself. And also we have a concept like, say, quotient space. So in group theory, we can construct a quotient group using normal subgroups. If G is any group and N is a normal subgroup of G, then we know that G by N is the quotient group. In case of rings, what we have done is, so if R is any ring, I is the ideal, R by I is the ideal. Here too, and in vector space also, you know that how to construct a quotient space. Quotient space can be constructed using the subspaces. So you know that if we W is any subspace of a vector space V, then we can construct the quotient space V by W. Here too, yes, if M is any subspace of a nonlinear space X, then we construct the quotient space denoted by the symbol X over M. So how the X over M looks? It contains set of all elements of the form X plus M, where X belongs to X. X plus M, where X belongs to X. So this is the quotient space. So now, if it is the subspace of, this is again definitely a subspace of X itself. Now you know the subspace, the norm of a subspace, you know, we have defined it. So how to define the norm of the subspace, norm for this X over M? Although the elements are not looking in the version, looking of the form of the elements of X, so they are all in X itself, because X is an element of X, M is a subspace of X, means they are also elements of X. So all the elements are in X itself, but they are looking little different, right? So now how to define the norm on these quotient elements of quotient spaces? Say if you take a element, some element, say X plus M is one of the element in this one, say quotient space, then we define this by infimum of norm of X plus M is infimum of norm of X plus M, where M ranges over M. We will take norm of X plus M as infimum of norm of X plus M, where M ranges over M. We will take this infimum, the smallest one, right? So now, say we have one important theorem based on quotient spaces. So now the theorem states, suppose M is closed linear subspace of a non-linear space X. Suppose M is a closed linear subspace of a non-linear space X. So if the norm of the coset, X plus M in the quotient space is defined as this, then we can show that X by M itself is a norm linear space. X by M itself is a norm linear space. And further, the important thing is, if X is a Banach space, means X is complete, X is a Banach space, then X by M is also a, then X by M is also a Banach space. X by M is also a Banach space. This is the statement. Means, if M is a closed linear subspace of a norm linear space X, and if norm of a coset X plus M is defined like this, then with respect to this, X by M becomes a norm linear space. Further, if X is a Banach space, then so is X by M. X by M is also a Banach space. Let's look at the proof. So now, we don't need to show that this is a linear space. X by M is a linear space. Quotient space, you have studied it in this one, linear algebra classes. Only thing is, we can show that this is a, the what we have constructed, this will be a norm on X by M. We can prove this. This is a norm on X by M. Okay. For this, so the first condition is what? Norm of X plus M must be, norm of X plus M must be non-negative. This is the first condition, right? Now, norm of X plus M contains what? This contains elements X plus M, where X belongs to X. Now, this is norm of X plus M is norm of X plus M, where M belongs to M. Now, norm of X plus M, little m, this is a little m, norm of X plus M is a non-negative real number. And you know that every set of non-negative real numbers is bounded below, okay? So, if bounded below means infimum exists, therefore, infimum of norm of X plus M, where M belongs to M, exists. Since this is non-negative, infimum is also non-negative. Therefore, we can say that norm of X plus M is non-negative, okay? So, let's come to the second point. Now, norm of X plus M is 0. What is the second condition? Norm of X plus M is equal to 0 if and only if X plus M is equal to 0. X plus M is equal to 0. What is this 0 denotes? Why I written it with bold letter 0. What is the 0 element of X by M? 0 element of X by M is nothing but, you know, from vector spaces, that 0 element of X by M is M itself. Because if you add any element X plus M plus M, it becomes X plus M itself. So this is the 0 element. Now, firstly, if you assume that norm of X plus M may be equal to 0. Suppose norm of X plus M is 0. Norm of X plus M is 0 means norm is by definition infimum of norm of X plus M, where M belongs to M, is 0. Now, infimum of these numbers, these are the non-negative numbers. Infimum of these numbers is 0 implies what will happen? There exists a sequence of numbers, say Mn. There exists a sequence of numbers Mn in M such that limit n tends to infinity norm of X plus Mn is equal to 0. Because infimum of 0 means after certain stages, there must be a sequence of elements so that this will be equal to 0, means that sequence I denote it by M. Limit n tends to infinity norm of X plus Mn is equal to 0. This implies limit of n tends to infinity Mn is equal to what? Minus X. Because limit n tends to infinity X plus Mn itself is 0, that means limit n tends to infinity Mn is equal to minus X. Now, look here. Say this is, now M is a closed subspace. M is closed subspace and Mn is a convergent sequence in M. Mn is a convergent sequence in M, and M is closed means what? What will happen? The convergent point minus X belongs to M. This is by the definition of a closeness. Okay. As M is a subspace, again, if minus of X belongs to M means X itself minus of minus X, that is X itself belongs to M. Now, if X belongs to M, what you can say that X plus M is nothing but M, that is 0 element of X by M. Thus, what we have proved, norm of X plus M is 0 imply X plus M itself is 0. One way we have proved. Conversely, what is the converse part? Conversely, suppose that X plus M is 0, means 0 element of X by M is, that is M, so that is X plus M is equal to M. If x plus m is equal to m, what it implies? X is equal to, x belongs to m. If x belongs to m, now consider norm of x plus m. If norm of x plus m is equal to infimum of norm of x plus m, where x comma m belongs to m, because here we assume that x belongs to m. So infimum of norm of y, where y is equal to what? We denote it by x plus m. This is a, if x comma m belongs to m, x plus m certainly belongs to m. So this is equal to infimum of norm of y, where y belongs to m. Since now m is a subspace, infimum of norm of the elements of m is what? Which is nothing but 0. Length of that is norm of any element, infimum smallest is the element is 0. Thus x plus m is equal to 0 implies norm of x plus m is equal to 0, means we have assumed that x plus m is equal to 0 and we have shown that norm of x plus m is 0. Thus norm of x plus m is 0 if and only if x plus m is equal to 0. Let's come to the third condition. Third condition is norm of x plus m plus y plus m is less than or equal to norm of x plus m plus norm of y plus m. Now x plus m plus y plus m is what? X plus y plus m. Okay. Therefore, norm of x plus m plus y plus m is what? Norm of x, by definition of a addition of the cosets. Yes, this is x plus y plus m. So norm of x plus y plus m is, this is treated as a single element. So this is equal to infimum of norm of x plus y plus m, where m belongs to m. Now see here, I'll take m is equal to m1 plus m2, where m1 m2 belongs to m. This is always possible in case of linear spaces. Why? Because you know that every vector space when we split it as, we can split it as w1 and w2. We can always split any vector space as the sum of two subspaces. So this is therefore x norm of x plus m plus y plus m is equal to infimum of norm of, say, x plus y plus m1 plus m2. I can write it as, I will join m1 with x and m2 with y. Infimum of norm of x plus m1 plus y plus m2, where m1 m2 belongs to m. So I split this norm, because norm of x plus y is less than or equal to norm of x plus norm of y. I use that property and I split this infimum of m1 m2 belongs to m, norm of x plus m1 plus y plus m2. So this is less than or equal to infimum of m1 belongs to m, norm of x plus m1 plus infimum of m2 belongs to m, infimum norm of y plus m2. So this is nothing but the definition of norm of x plus m. This is the definition of y plus m. Thus norm of x plus m plus y plus m is less than or equal to what? Norm of x plus m plus norm of y plus m. So let's come to the last condition. What is the last condition? Say norm of alpha into x plus m is mod of alpha into norm of x plus m. So if I take alpha is 0, then clearly both sides it will be 0 and the equality is trivial. So assume that alpha is non-zero and consider norm of alpha into x plus m. This is equal to alpha into x plus m is alpha x plus, this is alpha x plus m. So this is equal to what will happen? Infimum of, because why we have taken alpha x plus alpha m? Because alpha into m is itself is m itself, because it is a subspace or linear space. So this is equal to infimum of norm of alpha x plus m, by definition I am using the definition of a norm. So m belongs to m. So infimum of norm of alpha x plus alpha into m, where m belongs to m. There is, if you write instead of m, if I write alpha into m, then also it is true, because if m belongs to m, alpha into m also belongs to m, by the definition of the subspace or the vector space. So this is equal to, I'll take mod of alpha into infimum of this. So infimum of this norm of x plus m, where m belongs to m. So this is nothing but mod of alpha into norm of x plus m. Thus we have proved all the condition of a norm. Therefore the norm what we have considered for norm of x plus m, that is norm of x plus m is equal to infimum of norm of x plus m, where m belongs to m, is a norm on x by m or x over m. Thus x over m is a norm linear space. Now the next thing is, so we need to show if x is a Banach space, then x by m is also a Banach space. So that is, if x is complete, then x by image is also complete. Now here to prove the completeness of x by m, we make one important result of reanalysis, that a sequence is convergent if it has a convergent subsequence, that you have studied in your analysis class. Here we make use of the fact that a Cauchy sequence is convergent if and only if it has a convergent subsequence. So for this, let us take up one Cauchy sequence in x by m. Let xn plus m be a Cauchy sequence in x by m. Let xn plus m be a Cauchy sequence in m by m. Take epsilon is equal to off. By definition of a Cauchy sequence, what will happen? Given epsilon positive, epsilon is equal to off, I will take an epsilon positive. There exists a positive integer. There exists a positive integer n1 such that for all l comma m greater than or equal to n1 implies norm of xl plus m is one element minus xm plus m is less than epsilon, that is off. So now in particular, I can replace l with n1 because it is greater than or equal to. So in particular, I can take norm of xn1 plus m minus xm plus m is less than 1 over 2. Now I will write xn1 is equal to y1. Then what will happen? Norm of y1 plus m minus xm plus m is less than 1 over 2. So similarly, you take for epsilon is equal to 1 by 2 square, there exists another positive integer, say n2, which is greater than n1, such that what will happen? Norm of xn2 plus m minus xm plus m is less than 1 by 2 square for m greater than n2. This is very important for m greater than n2. So I again set xn2 is y2, then norm of y2 plus m minus xm plus m is less than 1 by 2 square. So if we generalize this concept, what will happen? We have a positive integer nk, which is greater than nk minus 1 and so on, greater than n1, such that what will happen? Norm of yk plus m minus xm plus m, I keep as it is less than 1 by 2 raised to k. So where yk is what? xnk, and m is greater than nk. This is the condition. Okay. Now, thus we have obtained a subsequence. What is the subsequence we have obtained? Yn plus m. We have obtained the subsequence yn plus m of the sequence xn plus m in x by m, such that what will happen? Norm of yk plus 1 plus m minus yk plus m is less than 1 by 2 raised to k. So this is the thing we have proved. Now it remains to show that this subsequence converges to a point in x by m. This is the thing. So a Cauchy sequence converges if and only if it has a convergent subsequence. That is the thing we are proving it. So now choose a vector z1 in coset y1 plus m. Choose a vector z1 in y1 plus m. After choosing z1, we select z2 in y2 plus m, such that norm of z2 minus z1 or z1 minus z2 is less than half. Again, select z3 in y3 plus m, such that z2 minus z3 is less than 1 by 2 square. So continuing this way, we get a sequence. What is the sequence you get? Zn in x, such that norm of zn minus zn plus 1 is less than 1 by 2 raised to n for n is equal to 1, 2 and so on. So clearly this zn is a Cauchy sequence. So that thing we have proved here. So zn is a Cauchy, how to prove zn is a Cauchy sequence? Let epsilon positive, choose a positive integer n0. This so large that 1 by 2 raised to n0 minus 1 is less than epsilon. Then for n comma m greater than or equal to n0, we have norm of zm minus zn is zm minus, so I use the triangle in, I use the s I use so what will happen, say I add and subtract the next terms here, zm minus zm plus 1, plus zm plus 1 minus zm plus 2 and so on up to z1. So these are the terms that we introduce in between. So I use the triangle inequality now. Less than or equal to norm of zm minus zm plus 1 plus zm plus 1 minus zm plus 2 and so on. The last thing is norm of zn minus 1 minus zn. But we have consider according to our consideration of these zi's. So this is less than 1 by 2 raised to m plus 1 by 2 raised to m plus 1 and so on. So the terms are in GP. So I use the geometric progression sum. So this is less than or equal to, this is the value of this about sum is 1 by 2 raised to m minus 1, which is less than or equal to 1 by 2 raised to n naught minus 1, but 1 by 2 raised to n naught minus 1 is less than epsilon. So therefore Zn is a Cauchy sequence. Now Zn is a Cauchy sequence means what will happen? Zn is a Cauchy sequence in the space X. So but X is a complete space. If X is complete, every Cauchy sequence converges. Therefore we have the Cauchy sequence Zn converges to point Z. Consequently, if Zn converges to Z means what? Limit n tends to infinity yn itself is converges to z. And so limit n tends to infinity yn plus m is equal to z plus m. Z plus m belongs to where? Z belongs to x. Z plus m belongs to x by m. Thus the sequence xn plus m is a Cauchy sequence in x by m, which has a convergent subsequence. What is the convergent subsequence? Converging to point z plus m in x by m. So consequently the Cauchy sequence itself converges to point in x by m, meaning thereby that x by m is a complete space or x by m is a Banach space. So thus we have proved that. So if x is complete, x by m is also complete. The quotient space x by m is also complete. Okay, let's come to the next problem or next theorem. So here in this theorems, suppose x is a non-zero non-linear space. Suppose we have a set S is equal to, containing set of all x belongs to X, such that norm of X is less than or equal to 1. Suppose we have a set S, set of all X belongs to N, X such that norm of X is less than or equal to 1. Definitely this is a subspace of X. What is this subspace? Subspace geometrically, if you see this, this is looking like the unit disk. This is the unit disk in X. Then here we are going to prove that X is a Banach space or X is complete. X is a Banach space if and only if this set S is complete. So X is a Banach space if and only if S is complete. So what we do is here, first let X be a Banach space. Okay, say first you consider X to be a Banach space. What you have to show? The set S, what we have considered, this must be complete. Okay, so complete means, say let us take some Cauchy sequence, say xn in S. Let us consider a Cauchy sequence xn in S. Since each of the elements belongs to S, what will happen? By definition of S, norm of xn is less than or equal to 1 for each n. Okay, now S is contained in S because S is a subspace of X itself. So S is a subspace of X means this is also a Cauchy sequence, xn is also a Cauchy sequence in X itself. But we have assumed that X is Banach space, means X is a complete. This is complete means this Cauchy sequence converges to a point in X. Okay, say xn converges to a point X belongs to X. Okay, but already we have shown that norm is a continuous function. So norm is a continuous function, but function means what will happen? Norm of xn minus x, okay, norm of xn converges to norm of x. So if xn converges to x, norm of xn converges to norm of x. Therefore norm of xn is equal to, what will happen? Converges means limit n tends to infinity, norm of xn. But norm of xn is what? Less than or equal to 1 for each n. This implies what? Norm of x itself is less than or equal to 1. Norm of x is less than or equal to 1 implies what? This implies x belongs to Yes, means we have a Cauchy sequence that we consider in S, and we have shown that that Cauchy sequence converges to a point in X, that point is in S itself. Therefore, what you can say, S is complete, S is complete, or S is a Banach space. S is complete. So we have assumed that X is a Banach space or X is a complete space, and we have shown that S is complete. Now let us take up the converse part. Converse part is what? Conversely, we will take conversely, what we will take? Conversely, let X be a Banach. Let conversely, let S be complete. Sorry, let S be complete. Conversely, let S be complete, and we will show that X is a Banach space, means X is also complete. So we will show that S is complete implies X is also complete. Okay. Now X is complete means again we need to take some Cauchy sequence in X. Let Yn be a Cauchy sequence. Cauchy sequence. So by definition of a Cauchy sequence, what will happen? Norm of Yn minus Ym tends to 0 as n comma m tending to infinity. So norm of Yn minus Ym tends to 0 as m comma n tending to infinity. Now for each n, so you define the vector xn as yn by norm of yn. You define the for each n, you define the vector to be xn is equal to yn by norm of yn. Then what is what about norm of xn? Then norm of xn is equal to norm of yn by norm of yn. So this is equal to norm of yn is a scalar that can be taken out. So if you take this out, what will happen? Norm of yn into the remaining thing is norm of yn itself again in the numerator. So this gives 1, means norm of xn is equal to 1. So norm of xn is equal to 1 means what? Xn belongs to S. The constructed vector xn that belongs to S now. Say next, say now we show that this xn is a Cauchy sequence in S. We can show that this xn is a Cauchy sequence in S. So for this, if you wish, so you take Cauchy sequence means we will take norm of xm minus xn. Norm of x minus xn is equal to norm of xm means ym by norm of ym. Xn means yn by norm of yn. So this is equal to ym by norm of ym. I will keep as it is. I add and subtract the term yn by norm of ym. So this is equal to what will happen? Ym by yn by norm of ym, add and subtract, and I will group these two terms according to convention that is explained in. Okay, so what we'll see that you can see that the total sum will be equal to 2 times norm of ym minus yn by norm of ym. But yn minus ym, yn is a Cauchy sequence, so what will happen? This tends to 0 as m and n tends to infinity. So xn is also a Cauchy sequence in S. But S is complete, as you know, S is complete, hence the Cauchy sequence xn converges to a point in X, such that xn converges to X. But xn is what? Xn is nothing but yn by norm of yn. So that converges to X, means you call this as number 2. So if you call this as number 2, what will happen? Also, you know that this is the condition that we have proved in the beginning of the class itself, in the session 1. Mod of norm of yn minus norm of ym is less than or equal to norm of yn minus ym. Okay, this tends to 0 definitely as mn tends to infinity, means as mn tending to infinity, mod of norm of ym minus norm of yn, these are scalars, these are tends to 0 means these are real numbers. Norm is a real number because norm is a mapping from X to R. Okay, this is a real number, means this acts as a Cauchy sequence of real numbers, but R is complete, and so this is a Cauchy sequence as this is norm of ym minus norm of n tends to 0 as m Therefore, norm of yn is a Cauchy sequence of real numbers. But r is complete, so norm of yn, r is complete means, so we have norm of yn converges to say alpha belongs to r. And consequently, by 2, what will happen? According to 2, norm of yn converges to alpha means yn converges to, what is that? Norm of yn converges to alpha into, say this is alpha into x. So norm of yn is s, alpha into x, that belongs to r itself. And consequently, norm of yn converges to alpha belongs to r, and consequently by 2 we have yn converges to what? Alpha into x belongs to x itself. Okay, therefore x is complete. We have taken the Cauchy sequence yn in x and we have shown that converges to a point in x itself. Therefore x is a complete space, and so it is a Banach space. Thus if s is complete, then x is also complete. This is the proof of the theorem. Thank you.